I'm Chris Hayward and I play Charles Petrescu.
I'm David O and I play Brian. He's a lonely man living in the depths of Wales, and to keep his hands busy, he makes these little inventions that aren't very good, but he takes a lot of pleasure from them. And then one day he decides, for companionship, to have a go at building a robot as a friend. Yeah.
That robot is in the unique shape and form of Mr. Charles Petrescu. Chris, can you talk to us a little bit about what is unique about Charles amongst the myriad of versions of AI and robots we've seen on screen throughout human history?
Well, what's unique is he has the head of a mannequin and his tummy is a washing machine. And he begins life as quite childlike. And then as he develops, he goes through stages of being like a Labrador, right through to being an angsty teenager.
Can you talk a little bit about the voice for Charles? Because it's such a distinctive element of both the humor and the heart of him.
Yeah, the voice is actually some computer software, which is brilliant because it just reads out sentences in weird ways. It has weird intonation, so it just gives him a quality that's quite unique.
Well, I mean, I guess the emotional heart of the story is a parent dealing with a child growing up and wanting to leave home and having to let go. And so I'm a dad and I've experienced that. So we kind of chuck that into the script and hopefully as an audience you'll feel it. So yeah.
Talking about feeling, I think obviously Charles is one great relationship for Brian, but Louise Brealey, the beautiful Louise Brealey as Hazel, is another very important one. Can you talk about working with her and what that dynamic gives to the story?
Well, Louise was amazing. When we did the casting, I feel like we really hit it off and felt like Brian and Hazel were two quirky individuals, lonely individuals that hadn't yet butt up against one another, and they need each other and eventually find one another, and yeah.
The film has so many fantastic moments. I'm curious, Chris, if you have one in particular that you either feel the most proud of or just makes you smile the most when you see it now on screen.
Well, when I had to dance in front of everyone, that was quite a weird thing to do. But I think that comes out quite well on screen, yeah.
That's proud of it?
I am proud of it, actually, yeah. It's exactly how I imagined it, so I am proud of it.
Yeah, I'm proud of it too.
Yeah. People do get the chance to enjoy the film here at the festival and beyond. David, what are you most hoping overall they take away from Brian and Charles's journey?
I want them to laugh and have a little cry and clap and just have a warm, fuzzy feeling in their tummy. Like a washing machine.
May or may not be made of a washing machine. And I think obviously music is such a beautiful element of the story as well. Were there particular songs that you guys were especially pleased to see in there that you enjoyed on set?
The music with Daniel, we were just so chuffed that he got him on board, and he's just added something else which has lifted the film. And we're just over the moon he got involved. It's brilliant.
You talk about the insane genius of Mr. Charles Petrescu's rap, because he's got mad flow.
Yeah, who would have thought that a robot with a washing machine for tummy could be such a brilliant rapper?
Yeah.
Number one, I think, next year. It's going to be number one.
Yeah,
definitely. And I guess, what does it mean for you guys to be not just a part of Sundance, but specifically Sundance London?
It means the world to me.
Well, for me, I just can't believe we're involved. It's like I was saying, we met up a few times here in the cafe, just coming up with ideas for the film, and now I'm here with that, and we're all part of it. And it's a thrill to have been chosen. Yeah.
We're here celebrating specifically independent cinema. I know it's a big question, but what do you think the value of independent storytelling is for an audience? What do they get from that they perhaps don't get from other forms of cinema?
Whoa.
Go for it.
That's a cracking question. No, come on.
I think you get unique stories, and people are allowed to express themselves in a way that you probably don't get so much with sort of more studio control. That's a heavy response.
I was just nodding. I'm loving it. Yeah.
David, just before we let you go, obviously Afterlife has been an astonishing success, and it's also been quite a poignant series for a lot of people. How do you feel about the impact that that series has had, and obviously being a part of something that's meant so much to so many people?
Yeah, I can't believe it. When you start something, you don't know what to expect, and over the last two or three years, more and more people keep popping up and saying how much it's helped them, or they've been entertained by it. So yeah, amazing to be part of something like that. Yeah,
I'd like for fans to see it in an actual cinema screen, like in the screen one at Sundance is like a dream come true. Like we made this film in the pandemic, so to have the opportunity to share it with a live audience is amazing.
Talk to us a little bit about the amazing and slightly unique journey for this film, from the original short, the comedy stuff, to where we see it now on screen.
Yeah, it started as a live show, like written by, like David was playing Brian as a live character, and then Chris came on board and took a, like created Charles for a sort of a live quiz show, and then we made the short. So it's been a sort of like, yeah, it's been a very strange, unusual journey. I don't know how many other shows come from sort of sketch comedy to this. But I'm just so pleased that we managed to get this far. We didn't want it to be like a just normal comedy. I think that was what we were keen on. Like, it could easily have been treated like very broadly and very brightly. But so we wanted to add that kind of darkness and depth to it, which kind of would engage an audience more. So yeah, that was an exciting thing, really, to like, add a bit of ambience, a bit of atmosphere, and a few tears along the way.
Can you talk a little bit about the technical challenges of breathing convincing life into Charles?
Yeah, I mean, the technical challenges, there weren't that many. I guess that really it was just like trying to get him to, fit through doorways and stuff like that. We had like our first version from the short, which was a cardboard box. So I guess we updated him a little bit by making it a plastic box, but other than that, it was just like slightly upgrading him a bit to make it feel like it matched the story of the film. Give him a metal eye for an instance and a slightly more updated, sort of look. I mean, David's like an amazing comic actor, but I think what a lot of people don't realise is he's an amazing dramatic actor as well. And yeah, Brian's just kind of got... He's kind of got it all. And what's great about presenting him in this kind of style is that, we get to like see all the sort of like the nuances of his performance. Like the way he talks to camera, I think, he's saying one thing but meaning another. And I think that's what's like so brilliant about that character and that performance.
I'm curious how much of the dialogue, particularly between Brian and Charles, was very tightly scripted and how much of it was ad-libbed.
I would say like 85% scripted. Well, saying that, like we'd improvise every scene. Like we'd start scripted and then we'd move as the text went on. By the end, they'd be more improvised. I think there's like two or three scenes that are like improvised from scratch. But the majority is like the script was great and we didn't have loads of time. So that's how we did it.
My final question, can you talk to us about the unique genius that is Charles's rap? He's got mad flow, that robot.
He has got mad flow. Yeah, he's a real G. That's a reason to stay for the end of the film. I don't want to say too much, but you get to hear a bit more from Charles's rhythms, if you will. Yeah.
Can you start by telling us a little bit about your character Eddie and where he fits into this tale?
Sure. So Eddie, we live in a small town. Eddie, to cut a long story short, Eddie is Brian's nemesis. And I think that in life, wherever they've been together, whatever Brian has, if Eddie wants it, then, he'll probably just take it.
He is a legitimately menacing presence throughout the film. Is it liberating to play someone that unapologetically nasty?
Oh, for sure. I mean, there's nothing nicer than playing someone as kind of, as brutal as Eddie. I mean, he's sort of like, he does exactly what, Yeah, he's a great, those are the most fun parts to play, for sure.
Can you talk a little bit about what it was like working with both David and, of course, Chris in a rather elaborate costume?
Well, I mean, obviously an absolute pleasure. I didn't know any of them before we did this film. I mean, trying to do a scene with David without him laughing was, you know, virtually impossible, which is always a joy. Chris is, oh my God, such a gentleman, such a brilliant human being. And then obviously, you know, the next thing you know, he's Charles Petrescu. And that's the bit where I couldn't keep it together. I mean, when he was when he was dressed up like that and coming out and doing some of the things he was doing, I mean, I just couldn't keep it together. It was very difficult. I've never corpsed so much in a film in my life.
For people who have not seen Mr. Charles Petrescu, if you had to give a description, you know, a police description for him, what would it be? How would you describe Charles?
A washing machine with a sense of humour.
Eerily accurate, eerily accurate. Talking about eerie, can you talk a little bit about the location for the film? Because I think it's another very big character in the story.
So, Murren, the DOP, amazing. We're in North Wales, near Snowdonia. Big shout out to Betsy Cohen, the town, which was stunning. Obviously, we were in lockdown, we were in COVID, so there was, you know, there wasn't really people out very much. We were kind of coming near the end of it, so then it started to get a bit busier. But, I mean, so beautiful. I have never been to Wales before, like North Wales before, and gorgeous, absolutely gorgeous. It was, and actually, you know, we talk about all the people in the film, the North Wales is another character in the film, and like I just implore people to please see it on in the cinema, because it looks so brilliant, and Murren's done the most amazing job.
A final question before I let you go and enjoy the screening tonight: what are you most hoping that audiences take away from the film? Because it's funny, but there's a lot of heart there as well.
Man, there's so much heart in it. That's what I was saying. Like, it's a film about loneliness, and it's a film about kind of like getting through this, and I think it's going to be healing for people. I do. I think there's a lot of people that are on their own, and I think that this is a film that's going to lift them out of that for whatever. But like, I don't think there's a comedy like it at the moment. I really don't, and I think that it's unique in that sense, you know.
Tell us a little bit about your character Hazel and where she fits into the adventure.
So Hazel is the human love interest in this extremely uneven love triangle. It's really a love story between Brian and Charles. Brian is a man, Charles is not a man. He is a 7-foot cabbage lubber. God damn it. I want to say landlubber, that's what I'm going for. Shall I just carry on? Okay, so Charles is not a man, he's a 7-foot cabbage loving robot. So if it is a love triangle, then their sides are very long and my side is very short, but I'm just happy to be in that triangle.
Can you talk a little bit about working with David? Because I think obviously there is something so very sweet, so very authentic about the affection and the awkwardness between these two characters.
I have to say, working with David is kind of like a sort of an awkward joy, because he's so brilliant that after most sort of takes or scenes, I would be like, he's incredible. Like, it's a bit like the Moscow Arts Theatre sort of way of doing it. He's been playing this character for so long, it's entirely in him. And so it's an amazing experience acting with someone who is that brilliant at their job. So that's cool. And my job was just sort of not mess it up. That was really honestly what I was thinking. Just tell the truth, don't mess it up. And you know, both Chris, who's the body, and you know, I mean, he is Charles, and David, who's obviously Brian, they just make it really easy. I know everyone always says that, but these things are a cliche for a reason.
And do you have either favorite moments on screen or favorite memories from set, things that make you smile the most when you think about this beautiful piece of cinema?
I don't have any favorite moments of me on screen, because that's a sweaty endurance test, which I've prepared by applying hand sanitizer into my armpits. Who knew? This is my life hack. It's absolutely amazing. It kills all bacteria. So even if you're really sweaty with fear, you're not stinky. But in I don't know. It's just, I thought the trailer was amazing. I mean, obviously I've seen the film, but the trailer is just, it just makes me grin. I had to have popcorn to watch it. It was so exciting. On set, I have to say that it was just brilliant to be able to do what we love doing. Like, for most of us, that was the first time we got to act in front of a camera in that horrible, difficult year, and just to be doing it was just felt really amazing. And I was high as a kite the whole time, really. But sometimes David and Chris would like do little, just sing little little songs together, and that was highly amusing. So on the cabbage, when the cabbages start flying around that night, the girls were on quad bikes, which I was very jealous of. Under normal circumstances, I'd have got on them, but obviously insurance won't allow for such things. But yeah, they would just sort of do duets to pass the time singing songs, which made me smile. It was lovely.
I think a lot of fans are also wondering if we're ever going to see you, Ben, and Martin back together again for more Sherlock. Do you think that's something we might get one of these days, or is everyone just too fantastically busy and important now to get the gang back together one last time?
Well, certainly, I think it's fair to say that Ben and Martin are pretty busy. I do have a stock answer to this, because it obviously comes up a lot, but to be completely honest, I think we'd all love to if the script was right and the time was right. When we finished the show, it wasn't officially an ending. I think we all thought we would come back at some point. Obviously, since we finished filming, we've lost Una Stubbs, and so it feels pretty unthinkable without her. I mean, she would absolutely 100% be furious if we didn't do it again, because she's gone. I mean, she would be raging. She can get very ragey, Una Stubbs, but she'd be cross. She would want us to get on with it. But I think if the script was right, it has to be about that, you know, because Ben and Martin are sort of, you know, they won't want to be a part of something which was so special to come back and do it in a way that doesn't feel better. It has to be better than what we did, and that bar's reasonably high. So I think, I hope we do it again. I'd love it. But it's not up to me, sadly.